Today I'm going to talk about performance optimization. I am the team leader of AdYourTrader. It's a real-time bidding platform. We do 100,000 requests a second, so we've been pushing the limits of Erlang and trying to optimize as much as possible the code. So today in my talk, I'm just going to discuss some tips, some patterns, and show some tools that we use on a daily basis to optimize and profile code. So we're going to start by actually getting kind of dirty and digging into code directly. So we're going to do a little exercise. It's pretty simple. We're going to try to build an HTTP server that returns the date and the time. It's a simple API, but we're going to be able to see a couple of different patterns while building this. So what do we need? The first thing, we need to be able to accept connection. Then we need to be able to parse HTTP requests, handle routing, and finally building a response. So let's start by accepting connections. This is basically the normal accept pattern. If you read the GenTCP documentation, that's probably the first code you'd come up with to accept. But if you look at it, first thing it does, it listens on the port, takes that socket, ships it to a loop, and that loop will continuously accept and spawn a new process. If you profile this loop, you'll find out that actually the main bottleneck in here is switching the controlling process. That's actually the expensive thing. So you might want to switch the model. So this is the model currently in that little loop. If we built an OTP application, so we'd have the application, a supervisor, and then the acceptor would be the one with the listening socket that would continually accept connections and then spawn a router to respond. So like I was saying, in that design, the slow point is a controlling process. But we can work around that. If instead of accepting in the acceptor loop, we spawn the process with the listener, the listening socket, and then accept in the worker process, we don't need to do this switch. So it would look a little bit more like this. Spawn a new process with the acceptor, accept, then ACK to the listener, and the listener will spawn a new process to start accepting again. There's also another little trick in there. At the bottom, there's Erlang yield. This actually helps for speeding up the accept, since instead of handling the request right away, it's going to yield, and someone else will be able to accept. So basically, this is what it looks like in this new pattern. The acceptor, you have a listener that receives the ACK. You have the acceptor that accepts, and then eventually, after accepting, becomes the router. So it calls the router. It doesn't spawn anything else. Now, this works well, but obviously, there's only one gen server. So it can only accept on one core, or one at a time. So what we want to do is have multiple listeners that will spawn multiple acceptors and accept multiple connections in parallel. If we wanted to optimize this even further, we could replace the gen server by a proclib to go more bare metal. There's actually a little bit of overhead if you use gen server. Another thing you could do is we didn't show it in the code, but when you create the TCP socket, you can give it at the TCP options. If you want to optimize for throughput, basically you probably want to make the backlog longer. You probably want to use binary format because processing lists is going to be a little bit costly just because of the memory overhead and copying around. And you can even go down to using raw options. In this case, this is something we use. It's TCP defer accept. So if a connection connects to the server and doesn't actually send data, the connection stays in the kernel and never goes down to the VM. This is Linux only, though. But if you read the documentation for sockets in Linux, there's plenty of little tricks like that. After that, the second step, we need to parse the request. This is actually really easy to do with Erlang. If you do packet HTTP, there's a BIF in Erlang that will parse it automatically for you, and you'll receive nicely formatted messages with all the HTTP stuff parsed for you. This is actually pretty fast, but you can beat it by actually just doing normal binary matching. It does perform better, but only in certain cases. Like if you have if you're running on a lot of cores and with hype, I was seeing in my benchmark that this was actually faster than the BIF. It's probably not always true, but it's nice to see that binary matching is very powerful. In this case, we're using only binaries just because it's more memory efficient. If the binary is over 64 bytes, it's never copied. It's shared in memory. And yeah, again, when parsing, we keep a state of the request. We keep it in a record just because records offer O1 lookups. It's a compile time thing, so it's always fast, and you don't have to worry about like having a dick that updates. And yeah. Now, for the routing, for this case, we don't need anything fancy. So pattern matching does everything we need. Basically, what we do in this case, we take the method URI, and then we pattern match on if it's a get date or get time. If not, then we return a 404. Can we make that faster? Honestly, I'm not sure unless we drop to C. This is actually one of the nice things. Pattern matching is really awesome, and it's fast. OK. Next one, we have to build the response. So the two response we need is one is for the date, and the second one is for time. So here, we're creating the date in the format that we saw earlier, basically the year, month, day, and a string. And in this case, we're just appending lists together, which is not that slow, but it's not the best way to do it. And then the other bottleneck we have in this code is actually we're calling Erlang now to get the time. That's really bad if you want to do it highly concurrently, because Erlang now has a lock, and it's going to become a major bottleneck. If we want to make this faster for the response, we can switch to OS timestamp. And in this case, I also switch, instead of keeping it in a list, it's a binary. And the idea of keeping it as a binary, I'll explain in the next slide, is that if we actually wanted to make it even faster, we could just cache it in ETS. So instead of rebuilding that response every time, you cache the binary in ETS. And since it's a binary over 64 bytes, it's never going to get copied. The reference is going to get passed. And you save memory and time. So if you want to build fast servers, fast stuff, use ETS. It's your friend. In this case, if it's only read-only, you should probably put read concurrency true. And in this case also, for the purpose of this API, you'd probably want to have a gen server that will have a timer and then update the value every second for the time and every day for the date. Now, this was just a little example. You shouldn't rewrite everything every time you start an app. There's plenty of good acceptor pools. There's plenty of web servers out there. I think the smart thing to do, especially if you're starting, is to use community projects and contribute back if you actually find a way to make it faster. All these optimization were kind of useless in theory, because when you actually build a real app, you'll have to speak to DB. You're going to have to do some slow operations while building the response. And it's going to offset all the work you've done anyways. So as usually said, like premature optimization is usually bad. It's usually not needed until much later at a high scale. So some little gotchas, some slow function and modules that you probably want to avoid. There's a couple. So Erlang now, as I said, has a lock. And if you just need the time and you don't need the special characteristic of the uniqueness of now, use OS timestamp. There's also a propless get value is written Erlang vs list key find, which is a BIF. So that one is much faster. Timer send, after, if you're using the module timer, it actually creates a process that will take care of your timer. If you use Erlang send after, it's actually going to use a timer wheel, which is much more efficient, especially when you have thousands and thousands of timers. If you want to actually, for UDP stuff, it's actually pretty easy to send directly to the port. So you can bypass GenUDP completely and just send your port command. Like I said earlier, another one that's kind of expensive, if you can avoid it, switching the controlling process of a socket. And then there's three modules that I usually try to avoid in anything performance. The Base64, the string module, and the Unicode modules. We have NIFs to do all of that, just because for us it's too slow. So now we're going to talk a little bit about tools. So one of the first things we usually do for figure out what's wrong or what's slow is we profile the code. There's two profilers that we usually use. There's fprof, part of Erlang, uses Erlang trace. You kind of get to understand eventually the outputs, but for a beginner, it's kind of complicated. There are projects to convert the output into a more meaningful output, and even to a k-cache grind format, so you can get a visual idea. The other one, it's more recent. I think it came out maybe 6 months ago from Prager. Also uses Erlang trace, but in this case has a really nice visual output. So when you do an eFlame, well, we can't really see well right now, but eFlame uses the flame chart library from Joyent, so you get nice visual graphs, and it makes it really easy to see where the time is spent, and it's actually really, really easy to use. All you have to do is call eFlame apply. You tell him what type of profile you want to do. If you want to follow the children, just follow that one function call. Or if you want to do fprof style, an output and your MFA. After, when you have your file, you just call a little bash script and actually generates the SVG file for you. Just a little gotcha. There's a hard-coded value for the resolution of the time. So I think it's hard-coded at 1 millisecond. If you want to see more granularity, you can bump it down to 1 microsecond and see really every call. But there's more overhead when that happens. So if we zoom in on the earlier graph, you can see here most of the time in the request was actually spent decoding URLs. with the XURI library. And on the other side, you'll see most of the time was spent base 64 encoding. So for those two bottlenecks, we actually just wrote NIFs, and they completely disappeared. Another technique is just doing micro benchmark. Those are useful when you know you have a problem and you're trying to figure out a solution.
The previous one did not show anything about concurrence.
Sorry?
Does Eflame show anything about concurrence?
Well, not if you're doing just calling an MFA, like it's not going to be concurrent by. But you can follow the children so you can see what the operations are. But no, it doesn't judge concurrency. So you have to test concurrency on the side. But in theory, you should know if your function is concurrent or not, and if there's like locks involved in the operation. Well, eventually, at least. But for these, for micro benchmarks, then it's easy to check for parallelism. So again, like I was saying, you probably don't want to start with this. It's more of a tool to experiment once you found a bottleneck. I wrote a little library called Timing. It's super simple. It uses the statistic library called Bear. This is kind of a demo. If you call, this would do the timing for that fun. So you pass it a fun. You pass it how many times you want to call that function, and you call you tell it how many processes at the same time are going to be calling it. So in this case, we're calling it 100,000 times, and with a parallelism of 1,000 at the same time. Just a quick example. I've done it with Erlang Now vs OS timestamp. With the parallelism of just one process at a time, they're pretty similar in speed. OS timestamp is actually always faster, but the difference is not that big. And you can see as soon as you start increasing parallelism, the locking of Erlang Now starts to show, and it becomes slower and slower. If you need speed, something else you can use is Hype, the native compiler for Erlang. My only issue is that we have a lot of NIFs in our case, so it doesn't really mix well. If you are going to use Hype, you want to be compiling your full Erlang code in the Hype so that you don't switch between native and non-native code. You want to be compiling with enable native libs. That way, all of your Erlang distribution is compiled natively. There's also some nice little hidden gems in there. There's some Hype biffs that you can call, but I don't know if it's generally not approved, but we do it just because it's nice to have some data structures that you can mutate sometimes. So Hype is actually really easy to use. If we use the same example of parsing the request earlier, we can compile it just normally without Hype. With the timing library, you can see that the mean usually is 46 microseconds. Compiled with Hype, we get down to 24 microseconds. So this is twice as fast just by adding one compiler option. The other tool we use, in our case quite a bit, are NIFs. A NIF is a function implemented in C. There are gotchas. It can be dangerous. If you have a seg fault, the whole VM will crash. If you have a memory leak, you're probably going to run out of memory. It needs to return fast. It can't block, obviously, or else a scheduler will block. The thing is, mostly on the internet, people say that it needs to return faster than 1 millisecond. In our case, we've measured that under 500 microseconds was safer, but even then, we have some problems with long schedules. Long schedules are basically processes that get scheduled for longer than their allowed time. So this happens when your NIF doesn't yield or blocks, and the reductions don't get bumped, and then the scheduler gets confused, and no other work can run at the same time, so it breaks the preemption of Erlang. The reductions are kind of hard to bump just because no one really knows what a reduction is. It's kind of this magical number that if you call a function, it bumps by one, but depending on your machine and the speed of your machine, the execution time of your NIF can vary. So how do you actually evaluate how many reductions you're supposed to bump is really hard to figure out. Hopefully in R17s, there's dirty scheduler support. So hopefully that should solve this issue, but I still haven't had time to play with the new dirty schedulers. Another optimization you can do is tuning your process. One option you can pass when you spawn is the mean heap size. If you know that your process is going to use a lot of memory, you're better off giving it a bigger heap size so that it doesn't need to try to compact in GC before growing. There's another option you could use is full sweep after, which permits you to force GC if you need to. If you're too lazy to tune manually each process, there's a VM argument that sets the default min heap size for the whole VM. This is what we do just because, in our case at least, most of the processes are pretty similar in size, so it just works. This is a graph, actually, when we enabled the HMS option. So we were doing 325,000 GC a second, and after that it dropped to maybe 8,000 GC a second. Another big part, if you're working with performance system, you need to do monitoring, see if it's still always running at the speed you expect, and to make sure any of your external service are doing okay, or if the OS or the system is okay. So for us, we do we use a couple of tools. We use StatsD Earl, which is a StatsD client that permits us to send application metrics. We use VM Stats that sits on top of StatsD Earl that gives us all the Erlang VM statistic. We also use System Stats, which gets system statistic like CPU load, and that sits on top of VM Stats. And then we also use Erlang System Monitor that permits to monitor different alerts from the Erlang VM. And finally, for live system exploration, we use NTOP. So StatsD Earl, like I said, is a StatsD client. It's super cheap to call. Everything's async. It offers us three kinds of metrics. Counters, which are good to count stuff that change in time, so QPS or number of hits on something. Gouges, which is for absolute values, so if you want to send the memory or anything that doesn't change continually. And then timers, which are kind of like gouges, but offers extra statistics. So for StatsD Earl, how does it work? It's really simple. You call the method, you pass it a key, you pass it by, well, information. So if it's an increment or a decrement, you pass it by how much you want to increment. And then the last part is the sampling rate. So for StatsD, we always sample. We don't send everything because we'd be sending millions of metrics. So in this case, we say send 50% of these calls to StatsD. For timers, this is kind of like the little pattern. Usually you do, you OS timestamp, call your method, do a diff, and then send it to StatsD. There's also some helper method. You can do a timing fun, which gives you the results and makes it easier. You don't have to do the boilerplate of OS timestamp every time. And there's also timing now that removes that now diff that you don't need to do. The other tool, VM Stats. VM Stats give you the process count, the number of messages in the queues, run queue length, all the memory information. So total memory, the total memory by process of the ATOM table of binary and ETS. It gives you the scheduler utilization, which is very useful. It gives you the number of garbage collection, so counts and words reclaimed, reductions, and I/O statistics. So I'm not sure, it's kind of hard to see, but this is the scheduler utilization on one box. I think there's 32 cores on that box, so there's 32 lines. You can see that it's basically at 74% capacity right now. It's really useful just because tracking like CPU would give you information, but because of the way the Erlang VM is done, the CPUs actually spin quite a bit. So even if there's no work, CPU might be high, but the utilization might be low. System stat. System stat gives us the load on the machine, gives us the CPU percent, virtual memory size, resident memory size. And that's really useful, especially if you have crashes and you want to see what's happening. You can see like if there's a slow leak, a fast leak, or yeah. So this is CPU percent. But like I said, it's kind of useless. Well, it's not useless, but it's hard to judge improvement in performance using this metrics just because the CPU, the VM is always spinning the schedulers. System monitor. System monitor is part of OTP. It's a tool that gives you alerts that you can register and you receive events. So you can get an event if you have a busy port. So if the buffer of the port is full and you can't send anymore, instead of blocking, it sends you a message if the buffer is full. Same thing, busy disk port. So if your distribution port is full, you'll get a message. Long GC. If you have a process that has a really large heap and it takes a long time to GC, you'll get alert. Long schedule, that's like I was talking about earlier. Long schedules is when the scheduler runs for too long on the same process. And then large heap, if the heap gets much bigger than allowed. To monitor this, we use React Sysmon, plus we have a custom handler that logs the lagger and sends metrics to StatsD. So if you want to use React Sysmon, basically you have to add an handler, and you can add your custom handler too. And our custom handler, as you guys can see, all we do is really we increment some metrics in StatsD and log what's going on. At the bottom, if you look, these are the logs you get. So it tells you which process was, in this case, they're mostly long scheduled, but which process was long scheduled, for how long, and it gives you the MFA of which function started when the process, this long schedule started, and the out. Finally, for all these monitoring tools, since we're sending everything to StatsD, we have a dashboard that's basically the graphite dashboard. And this way, we can see at a glance if anything is going wrong in the system. Another tool we use, but mostly for introspection, so if there's a problem on the VM and we receive an alert, first reflex usually is going to go check the dashboard, and then if we see, let's say, it's message queues or something that's blowing up, we're going to go use NTOP. NTOP is a top-like tool for the Erlang VM. One of the nice things, it can be used remotely, so you can connect from your laptop at home to the data center on the West Coast and just see the number of messages, the lengths of the queues, the heap size, the reductions. How it looks, it's really basic. but it's really useful when you're trying to figure out what's happening in the VM. So you can connect directly. There's a standalone script, so ntop the node name, and you can set the cookie if there's a cookie. So if you want to still get more performance out of it, you can tune the VM. There's a lot of settings. If you have a lot of TCP connections, you probably want to enable kernel polling. All these settings work well for us, but it's really you need to test in production or find a way to do load testing that's really similar as production, because often if you're just doing a synthetic benchmark on yourself, on like different machines, just because you might not have any other application competing with you, or the number of connections will be smaller. I'm saying this because, for example, kernel polling, if you're doing a benchmark, an HTTP benchmark with like 20 connections, it will be much, much, much faster without kernel polling. But as soon as you hit, 20,000 connections maybe, then kernel polling becomes much faster. Another setting that's really important, scheduler binding. You want to bind your schedulers. You don't want them moving around. Another option we use is we disable load distribution. For us, it lowered the latency, but again, you need to test. It might be negative for you. The other one we use is to force scheduler wakeups. There's some bugs with NIFs where the scheduler can possibly fall asleep and never wake up, so we have this option in case that happens. There's also SPP, which is for port parallelism. Enable it is supposed to help parallelize the ports between the schedulers. And if you're getting some busy disk ports errors, it's because your buffer is full. You can increase the distribution buffer using a ZDBBL. If you want to push even more, we use a tool called CSET. This permits us to create CPU set. We use CPU set to isolate process. That way they don't compete and there's no context switching. In our case, we run on Linux, so we usually reserve the two first CPUs for interrupts and for other background jobs, and we reserve the rest for the Erlang VM. On the image here, you can see CPU 0 is getting all the interrupts, and CPU 1 gets basically nothing. That's the default in Linux. So if you use CSET, basically you create what they call the shield. And in this case, we reserve CPU 0, well, thread 0, 2, 16, and 18 to be background jobs and interrupts, and the rest is for Erlang. So if you look at the column non-voluntary context switch, you'll see on the left that it goes up in the 1,000, and in the right, the highest value is maybe 50. So this is without the CPU set and with the CPU set. Finally, if you really want to continue pushing the envelope, you can use lock counter. The VM comes with a tool to find what the locks are. So using this, you can see, for example, in this case, we have contention of time of day and poll set. Time of day would be, well, for example, calling Erlang now. Poll set is for kernel polling, so there's contention. And in theory, that should get fixed whenever they merge that patch for multiple poll set in the VM, so one per scheduler. Other important tools, you need to tune your system limits. Obviously, you limit n, so the number of files, and all the sysctls. There is also dtrace and systemtap. There's a couple of talks today. Those are really useful tools to see what's happening not only at the application side, but also at the OS level. We used it pretty extensively to try to figure out why our NIFs were affecting the scheduler, but unfortunately, we never kind of figured out why. So these are links to basically all the projects I discussed during the talk. The slides will be up after, so it'll be easy to find the projects. Thank you.